the last day really we're going to spend on radiation, except you've got some homework due for Friday on radiation. I got this a little bit out of order tonight. The space station will be very visible. The weather should be good, I think, and it's really perfect. So at 8:54, it'll appear over the southwest horizon. It'll go directly overhead in about 3 minutes later, and then about 3 minutes later, it'll disappear over the northeast horizon. So it's really going to be easy to see. So, and if we, you know, use your phone or something to figure out the directions, whatever. And has anybody spotted the? Has anybody seen it before? A few of you have. Okay, good. So you know what to look for. If you get with somebody who's seen it, it's really easy once you know what to look for. It's really easy to spot. It just may be something that you need somebody to show you the first time. Did you have a question, Mr. Rico?
Yes. How often does it come, like, overhead?
Well, it comes overhead pretty often, but a lot of the times it's not visible because the lighting conditions are not right. So it'll come over in the daytime or it'll come over in night. And the problem is it doesn't have much of its own lighting. So what we see, we can see it most clearly at sunrise or sunset, where the reflected light is really strong. So it'll be, you know, it's at altitude, so it'll be dark here, but it's up and still in the sunlight. So you have to have those conditions right to really be able to see it. And so given that, it can come, you know, good opportunities like this come every 2 or 3 months, something like that. So it's not very often. Then it's cloudy or something.
Because I think I've seen it before, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, well, it could be. Usually it will be going from something in the west to something in the east. So it's either southwest to northeast or northwest to southeast or west to east sometimes. And it's usually at sunset or at sunrise if you want to get up early and see it. So if those were the conditions, it might well have been that. It's very steady light, doesn't blink at all. It's pretty bright, actually. Okay, let's see. So that's tonight, so might be a good opportunity. Tomorrow night we have a recitation in the conference room, 6 to 8, usual things. I'm going to get an old test and have you work some problems. I may actually add a couple of problems to that. In fact, I think I'm going to use this demo there as well tonight, see if we can figure out how this demo works. Friday, I'm going to have an overview of electricity and magnetism. That would be the big picture for you, putting it all together at one time. Monday and Wednesday, we're going to work on the practice test, which I'll either email to you or put on Blackboard. And there's actually two parts, pretty long test. And then Friday of next week, we'll do the in-class exam, covering 6 chapters of E&M. There's a lot there. Right? And then next week, hopefully, Mr. McKinnon and Mr. Friedel will show us their RF transmitter, which they think is almost working. It should be really cool. Okay, let's see. I can't resist. I didn't get to this demo, so I can't resist it. Mr. DiCarlo, why don't you come up here and help me with this, please? Okay, there's this thing can bite. You need to be careful. There's this magnet in here, which is pretty strong. I mean, you can feel, pull that. You can feel. Don't let it pinch you. It'll hurt. Okay. So now let's see here. Put that down. Let's put the document camera on here. And put it right there. Let's back it up. Okay, now so you see we've got a battery here with a magnet, right? And now we can make these little wire cages. This one would be good. And just put that down on there. So the cage fits so that it's making a contact both with the battery and the magnet. Got a little too excited here. Okay, now let's see. Why don't you switch the pole of the magnet? Why don't you flip the magnet opposite to what it is?
You would flip this like this?
Well, that could work too. Let's see. And then put this back on there. See if it spins the other direction. Okay, now let's try flipping the magnet itself. Put the battery back so it wasn't flip the magnet.
Flip like this?
No, just flip the magnet. Leave the battery. Yeah, there you go. Right. Okay. Now try putting the put that on there. Which way is it gonna go?
It Should go clockwise again, shouldn't it? No, counterclockwise.
So that's the way it went the first time?
No, it should be opposite. So the last two times have been in the same direction, right? Is that right? We switched.
I thought when I flipped the battery over, it was going that way.
So which way is it going? It's going this way.
Counterclockwise.
Counterclockwise.
Yeah.
Read on top. Now let's flip the battery. Just flip the battery. No, just the battery.
Oh, just the battery.
Just the battery.
That's what I was just doing, right?
Take the I'm sorry. I said battery.
Yeah.
Flip the magnet. There we go. You were doing what I told you to do. I was wondering what was so hard about it.
That
was going clockwise. Okay. So you'll find that there's, you know, we have two different directions here, the battery and the magnet. Two of them go one way, two of them go the other way. All right. So that's a cute problem. Let's work that in our recitation tomorrow night so we can figure out why this is doing what it's doing, right? Of course, it's creating kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is being activated. You know, the momentum, angular momentum of this thing is being activated. What's doing the work? Where is the energy coming from? It requires a battery, right? Eventually it'll stop. It'll run out of juice in the battery. Okay, so here's another one. This is pretty cool. Okay, now let's go back and do this. Okay, so I'm going to take that apart. Bring back up to the lecture capture. Okay, now let's see here. I'm going to put the screw on there. Using this battery, just make contact with the bottom of, it doesn't matter actually, either way. Make contact with the bottom there. It actually magnetizes the screw. You can lift it up. That's pretty strong.
It is.
All right, now, make contact here with the top. Hold it with your finger there on top. And then hold the whole thing up. There you go. Hold it all up.
Oh, like with this?
Table. No, not with that. There you go. Okay. And now touch the magnet with the other lead.
Is that safe?
It's safe.
Yeah. Oh, it spins.
Can
wow.
You see it over there? Show it so everybody can see it.
Check that out.
These are called homopolar motors.
That thing is going fast.
Motors. Yes.
So, can we make
Bubba's homopolar motors.
Yeah.
What?
If we flipped it, would
right,
it go
let's
down?
Try it. Let's okay. try it. What are you going to flip? You going to flip the battery?
The magnet.
Yeah. Well, let's try it. The easiest thing is to flip the battery.
Okay.
That's the easiest thing to do. Okay.
Which way was it going that time?
I think it was going this way.
Okay. So it's going clockwise
this
time.
It's going counterclockwise. This time it should go clockwise.
Slow. It is going clockwise, but it's not as fast.
It's not as fast. Well,
it might not be right on the.
Yeah, it might not be. Let's try. Okay, now this time let's go back. When we had it this way, it was counterclockwise, right? Now let's flip the battery.
The magnet.
Yeah.
Okay. So this should be clockwise.
Again. Counterclockwise.
Counterclockwise again.
I mean, I'm sorry. Yes, it is clockwise. Opposite of what it was before. There
yeah,
we go.
Clockwise. So now it's moving.
Yeah, it seems to be have less friction or something when it's hanging from the bottom of the
That's
battery.
Pretty cool. Where can you get one of these magnets?
They're pretty intense. They're probably a neodymium magnet. They're not cheap, and I guess you can get it probably from any science supply place. You know, like any of those places where you can get stuff like this. And you have to be a little careful because they do bite.
Yeah.
You pinch yourself with it pretty good.
You see how fast that thing's going?
Yeah, it's moving, isn't it? Yeah. So, between now and tomorrow night, why don't you see if you can figure out in your mind why these things are doing what they're doing, right? Is it, and obviously it's induction, but can you explain it? Explain the induction. Let's put this battery on. And it's, you can hear it's crinkly. There's some kind of paint on this thing, which is protecting it. So and you have to store them carefully, because everything gloms on when I put it in there. So you put it in there to keep so you can separate it more easily. You don't have everything stuck onto the magnet. Okay, so now let's see here. Induction experiments are so fun, you know, there's a lot you can do with them. Okay, so we're studying the analogical impetus and momentum and kinetic energy that are carried by light, and we're doing that by studying an A field, a sinusoidal A field, propagating. Well, so let me write it down here and ask you a few questions. So I guess I wrote it as omega t minus az. Okay, having written this, what is the direction of propagation?
To the right.
To the right for z, right? Plus z propagates in the plus z direction. And the A field itself is pointing in the x direction, so A is along x hat. So A is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. It's called a transverse wave because A is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. Okay, and. Now, we're going to study this, the effect of this A wave on a damped simple harmonic oscillator, that is a damped dipole. We'll nail one end of the dipole. In fact, we'll just consider really the effect only on the positive end, plus Q. And we'll study what's going to happen to that. We'll nail this to one end. We'll study what's going to happen to that charge. And we'll say that it's damped. And now there's a natural frequency for this because there's a spring constant. You've got to call it something other than K. I'll call it big K. Is the spring constant and the mass. And so the natural frequency for this oscillator is big K over M. We're going to tune this target so that the radiation will resonate with it, which means that we want to tune the mass and the spring constant so that it matches the frequency of the radiation, so that it's on resonance. And that's because we want to get the maximum effect. We want to see what is the maximum effect that we can have on this target. Radiation is coming in, and it causes an oscillation in this damped oscillator, and we want there to be the maximum amount of effect, so we tune the parameters of the oscillator to be on resonance. Yes, sir?
What direction is the spring moving in?
Yeah, right. So let's leave it kind of open for now and see what happens. Okay. Let's just.
Are we going to figure it out?
Well, we'll find out what happens, and it'll be probably. I mean, what we'll see is that the forcing is going to be in the x direction, and so it will be natural just to leave it. If we just start it so that it's pointing in the x direction, then the forcing will be in the x direction. Nothing else is happening in the other two directions. So, right. Okay. So now, before we do this, so we're going to solve for this motion. And I started this last time. We're going to solve for this motion. And let's suppose we have just displacement in the x direction. And then there's the forcing term. Force on it. So we're going to solve this. We're not actually going to solve it. We're going to look up the solution that was in PFR mechanics, right? We haven't learned how to solve this exactly. But we're going to look it up. And this is the damped driven oscillator problem again, where this driving force will be sinusoidal. But before we do that, let's go back a minute here and just get context again. Where did this A field come from? It was an antenna, right? That's right. And why did it come out to be a sine wave? The antenna had a basic frequency of omega. It was an AC antenna, so the antenna had a sine wave to it in time, and then the sine wave is propagated outward in space from the antenna. So that's why we're studying a sine wave here. Now, very often we study sine waves. When we're studying wave propagation, we study sine waves. And that's because they're very simple to study. They have a fixed frequency. So this is called a pure mode. And the pure mode means that everything oscillates with the same frequency. Everything. In other words, all parts. All parts of the plana. And when I say oscillate, what I mean is the A field in all parts of the plana. All parts of the plana oscillate at the same frequency. So it's a pure mode. It would be a pure color, or in the analog to sound, it would be a pure frequency and sound, a pure pitch. And so it's nice to study because it's simple, but don't get the impression that all waves are just sine waves. That's the problem with this. Remember, you showed in your homework in previous time and also today that any propagating solution is a solution to the wave equation. So the shape of this wave is determined by the source. And we just picked the source that had this characteristic behavior of having just a pure frequency. Okay, so you could have any other shape here, but we're going to study pure modes just for now. Okay? All right. So now let's go through the solution and dividing by the mass, then we have the force over m. But what is the force? Well, okay, now the first order, the force, remember we want the Lorentz force here. And we're ignoring the phi part. And so we're going to ignore this part first. We're just looking at the A effects, what happens because of the A field. And so we, to get there, let's see here. We can then calculate the E field, which is the A dot. It comes from the A dot. And so the E field looks like cos omega t minus kz in the x direction. And the B field looks like B naught cos omega t. That comes from the curl. In the y hat direction, where we have, as in the book, z, x, and y. Okay, so E and B are perpendicular to each other and perpendicular to the direction of propagation. E is perpendicular to B. E is parallel to A, or actually anti-parallel to A. There's a parallel to A. Anyway, it's along the x direction. And the direction of propagation, z hat, is propagation direction. Okay, so we notice also by taking the curl that the magnitude of the B field and the magnitude of the E field are the same, and we also know that wave number k in the wave equation in the solution must match up to the frequency. That comes from the wave equation. That's an expression of the property of the plana. The wavelength of this is determined by the speed of propagation and the frequency. Okay. So now we want to consider then, looking at these terms in the force, the last term, the one involving the velocity, is the weakest, because the velocity is not going to be a very strong is not going to be a very high fraction of the speed of light. So we're going to neglect this first to get an approximate solution. Let's just look at the effect of the electric field on the charge first. Okay, so going back to the chapter on the simple harmonic oscillator with the damping, we have this situation. We're going to picking z equals to zero. Let's put the oscillator at a convenient place in the coordinate system, or otherwise choose the coordinate system where the target is, so we don't have to consider the z. Okay, now the solution to this was given in, let me write it here, went down x. the solution to this was given in the chapter on the simple harmonic oscillator, and we looked at that recently. I'm going to write it down here for you and then analyze this. This was the general solution at so this first piece in front of the cosine is the amplitude of the response, and then we have a phase factor phi. But we're going, and so this phase factor phi depends on frequency as well. Somewhat complicated function of frequency, but remember that we chose, in order to get maximum response in the target, we chose the oscillator frequency of the target to match the antenna frequency, which gives us a resonance. Okay, so in that case, this simplifies. Phi at resonance is equal to negative pi over 2, okay, which gives us then just a cos, gives you a sine. Yeah. Cos omega t minus pi over 2, so it's sine omega t. So that's the behavior on resonance. There, from which we can get the velocity, just take a time derivative, and this omega is the same thing, we just use omega, because omega is equal to omega naught, or omega naught is equal to omega, and we take the time derivative, then we get q e naught m beta cosine omega t, and that's in the x direction, right? So we get oscillation in the x direction. Okay, and notice that the oscillation, the cosine is in, is now in, the velocity is in phase with the, it's actually, I think I've got a, must have a sine, let's see, sine omega t cosine, cosine. There's a negative sign here, and then a negative sign there. Okay. Okay, so notice that the velocity is exactly out of phase with the electric field. But it's in the direction of the electric field, but it's the velocity is out of phase with the electric field. Yes, sir, Mr. Luke.
Can you go over how we lost the 1 over C in the force equation, got the over M?
Did I lose it? That's in the E naught there. The 1 over C? Are you talking about?
Yeah, so like in the Lorentz force, it's
a yeah,
force
there's a C here, and you take the derivative of A, right? So E naught is related to A naught. And there's a factor of C in there.
Okay, and that's how we get the M too?
Yeah. Okay. Well, the M comes because I've divided
the
original equation by the mass.
All right.
And so there's a the E naught, I guess, is 1 over C, is it 1 over C omega over C A naught. That must be the E naught. Okay? Which is K A naught. E naught is K A naught as well. Okay, so to bring it back to A naught, we would put a K A naught here in this expression. Okay, so the A field, the A dot effect, causes this charge to oscillate along the x direction. But now we have a moving charge in the presence of a B field, and what's the direction of the B field? B field is coming out of the page. It's also oscillating in time. So it's a little bit complicated here. But we're going to now examine the force that's acting. So the force due to B is going to be the Q V over C cross B. And B, we said, is given by that. And that's in the X direction. Beta. And B, hope I've got my signs right here. There's B, B naught cos omega t in the y hat direction. Okay, so what is the direction of this magnetic force? And there are a lot of terms here. Q squared, E naught, B naught over M beta C. And remember, E naught and B naught are both are equal to each other and related to the A naught, the strength of the original A field. There's another K. And so we have cos squared omega T. And what's the direction of the force?
Negative C.
That, and so I've got a problem here. It should come out positive Z hat. And I've gotten messed up in my signs. And my notes weren't careful enough. So that should be plus Z hat. So I've got a sign error here somewhere. This is all done in the book, so it's careful. He gets the correct sign here. So notice that the force due to the magnetic field, the interaction of this oscillating charge now with the magnetic field is to the right, and it's always to the right. It's pushing away the charge. Cos squared omega t is always greater than or equal to zero. It's never negative. On average, that if you average over time, take the average over time, this is will be a half over time. So over time, the average force over time produced by this piece is going to be then the k squared a naught squared m beta c, and then 1/2 in the z direction. So it produces over a cycle, a complete cycle, it produces a net force, pushes the particle away, pushing this thing towards the z hat direction. In the other direction, okay, so that's, it's now that it's accelerating this charge, so that charge is also going to be generating its own A field and phi field. So there's more to this problem, right? So, but we're not going to consider that. We're just going to stop at this point. Let's just look at the effect of this original radiation from the first antenna on this oscillating dipole. Okay. Now, in fact, let me do it this way. Okay. So the force in that z direction, remember, gives us a momentum or an impetus in the z direction, and it's along that z direction. So it also produces a kinetic energy, and the rate at which the kinetic energy is produced, remember, is the force times velocity. So this is the force in the z direction times, the force is in the x direction. So it's exciting the oscillator. Okay, so this is going to be that Q squared E naught, B naught over C beta M. And on the average, it's going to be 1/2. But in time, it's going to do that. And this is going to be also Q naught, E naught squared, substituting in the velocity. That should be the velocity in the x direction. Again, sorry about that. Okay, so we have it's giving impetus to the target in the z direction, but it's also giving it kinetic energy. What is the relationship between the kinetic energy given and the impetus in that z direction? Let's look at that ratio. We can get that by taking the ratio of these time derivatives. Well, that's very simple. It turns out to be C. When you take the ratio of those two things, it's just C. So if we, there's a relationship then between the amount of kinetic energy that's delivered and the amount of momentum that's delivered. Very simple. Okay, now going back, trolling back in your memory when we were doing kinetic energy back in the first semester, chapter 4, we define kinetic energy as the rate at which momentum is transported, the intensity of the impetus. It's transported in the direction of its motion, of course. So that if we had a body that was moving, a massive body that has mass m, its speed will be p over m, that's Buridan's law. So increasing the amount of momentum it's carrying would increase the amount of kinetic energy it's carrying in proportion to that velocity, to that speed. And remember, massive bodies, the velocity of a massive body is dependent on how much momentum it has, on its impetus. And this is how we got to K is 1/2 p squared over m, right? That 1/2 comes because this velocity is variable. Now look at what we've got. This thing, instead of a velocity of a massive body, we have the speed of light. So the energy being transported is just the integral with respect to the momentum. Or better, the energy, because it's not really kinetic energy, it's really more properly an analog to kinetic energy. You see the relationship that the energy of the light, analogous energy of the light, is proportional to its momentum, pc. Whereas before we have 1/2 p squared over m, now we have, there's no mass. Light has no mass. Well, remember, light is not itself a substance. Light is a property of the quanta. But we have this analogous relationship here. So the kinetic energy, or the energy of light, is just proportional to its momentum, just pc. See that key difference here, that massive bodies, the speed is variable and dependent on the momentum, but for light, the speed is always the same. It's always c. It doesn't matter how fast the target is moving, how fast the source is moving, light, propagation of light, the rate at which momentum is transported is always c. Or the speed involved in that transport is always c. So that's the sense in which we can talk about analogous energy and momentum in light. It can transport from one substance to another, giving the second substance as a result an impetus and a kinetic energy. Okay, now before we go on to the homework for today, I wanted to just mention one thing briefly in passing. So we had this z direction was the direction of propagation. We have a y direction here. We said that the A field was oscillating in that along that y direction. And excuse me, that was our x. And then we have a perpendicular direction coming out, which was the y direction. And the E field is also along the x direction, and the B field is along the y direction in this case. Now, we could have taken our antenna and turned it on its side. Rather than being vertical, let's lay the antenna down on its side. Now, what does everything look like? Well, the A field now will be along the y hat direction. So A will be coming in and out of the board. So here we have E and A, and B is coming out of the board. Now we flip the antenna on its side. We still have the same direction of propagation, but we have A and E are both along the y direction, and now B is along the x direction. So it's light again, it's still light, but it's different, and the difference is called polarization. So these are the two different polarization states, one way of expressing the difference in polarization. So there's two polarizations. These are called, these particular waves, particular light waves are called linearly polarized. In linearly polarized light, the electric field is along, or the A field is along one particular direction and doesn't change. But there's two different independent such forms. So the light that you see normally coming at you has both polarizations mixed in together. And a Polaroid film will select out one of these states. It does so by having molecules that are stretched along a certain direction, and it favors the electric field propagating in one direction and dampens the electric field in the opposite direction. So a Polaroid would select, say, one of these two polarizations. reflected light, we haven't talked much about reflection here. We talked about, mentioned it briefly here. Reflected light tends to have, especially if it's off at an angle, off of glass or water or something, will tend to have a particular polarization. So if you orient your Polaroid film to select out the polarization of the light that's reflected, then it'll filter that out. You won't see so much glare. So that's how Polaroid sunglasses work. They are they're designed to be along the polarization of glare, which is reflected light, which has a naturally a certain angle in relation to the thing it's reflecting off of. So generally, when you're looking on water or you see the windshield of your car, the reflected light from the sun is at a certain polarization, and the Polaroid in your sunglasses will filter that out, passing through the polarization that isn't glare, so you can see stuff that isn't coming from the glare. That's how it cuts down on the glare. If you have two Polaroids and you put them at opposite directions, you filter out both polarizations and nothing comes through, so it's black. But if you turn them in the same direction, they're filtering out the same polarization twice, so it doesn't have any effect to have two Polaroids that are in this, any additional effect to have two Polaroids instead of one. All right, now there are various combinations of this, though. You could have, for example, have them out of phase. You could have the X polarization and then the Y polarization out of phase with each other, so that the Y polarization is out of phase with the X polarization. So the X polarization might have a maximum at one location or at one time, and the Y polarization might be at a different place at a different time. And that produces what's called circularly polarized light. The A field will actually swap off components in the X and Y direction. So it looks like the A field is rotating around the circle. And that's called circularly polarized. And the way I combined X and Y, I could do it in the opposite direction, so the rotation of A is in the opposite direction. So there's circularly polarized has two different kinds, depending on whether it's clockwise or counterclockwise, rotation of the A field. Looks like the A field is rotating. Of course, what it's doing is swapping off X and Y components in a correlated way, so that the sum of the squares of the AX and AY is a constant. So AX squared plus AY squared is a constant, because they're out of phase with each other, either in time or in space. So that's another way of looking at circularly polarized light. So if I take a circularly polarized light, put a Polaroid in front of it, I get the X portion or the Y portion. And so a Polaroid has not much effect on the intensity. A single Polaroid has not much effect on the intensity of circularly polarized light. There are a lot of interesting experiments you can do with Polaroids and light with these polarization experiments. Very interesting. Yes, sir, Mr. Coulter.
I was going to ask for a possible application of this. Isn't this how they use, how they make 3D movies?
I suppose you could. You could have different polarizations. I don't actually know. Is that what the modern 3D movies are doing?
I read something similar to this. It's like the lenses are circularly polarized in different directions.
Right.
And they have two cameras to capture an exposure, and right, they project both at the same time. So it reflects the glasses and it cuts out one.
Yeah, so actually you wouldn't have to have two special, the cameras that are filming it would not have to have the Polaroids in front of it, but the projectors would, right? The projectors would have to be polarized because the polarization would not be maintained. If you had a Polaroid on the camera and it is recorded on the film, then the projector would not automatically pick up on the polarization state, and it would just give you unpolarized light coming off, which is a combination of polarization. So I think the projectors would have to have the polarizers. It seems in principle it should work. I don't know in practice if that's how it's done, but in principle it would work. Yes, sir?
Going back to the previous slide.
Yes.
Could you set those relationships? Oh, go down a little bit. Could you set those relationships equal to each other to get the E equals MC squared?
No.
Okay.
No. So, and that's your, don't be led astray by all the symbols. Remember what this is. This is the analogous energy Q carried, transported by light, which is an activity of a plana and a massless object. Whereas this is the kinetic energy of a massive body with momenta, with some impetus whose measure is P. But this, remember, is the non-relativistic form. And in chapter 10, we saw that actually mass is increased. A massive body that has impetus, actually its mass increases. And that's not taken into account here, the fact that the mass is increasing with velocity. But the motion through the plana causes the body to gain mass. And if you correctly take that into account, then what you have is what you're getting at there, that there's a more complex relationship here between the kinetic energy and the mass and the momentum. So this needs to be modified to take into account the mass increase effect. That's where you would get that. Okay, so now let's look at the worksheet for today. Studying more about the wave equation. So the first, in general, if we have a function of a function, right? We have here some function of g of w, where w in this case is x minus ct. So a derivative of f with respect to x is going to be the derivative of g with respect to its argument, and then the partial derivative of w with respect to x. Whereas the partial of f with respect to time and you can see here dw dx is 1, whereas the partial with respect to time is just got this negative c. Okay, so you can see then that 1 over c squared partial with respect to f, second derivative of f with respect to time, minus partial second derivative with respect to x of f ends up being the second derivative of g, and then we have negative c squared over c squared minus 1, which gives 0 identically. Okay, so any g will satisfy. We studied a particular g, which was a sinusoidal wave. Any g will work, as long as it's differentiable. Okay, and now we noted also g of x minus ct is the function. Now, we want to track the place where some feature of g, we want to follow that feature of g. So a feature of g. Well, one feature would be, what is the value of the function of 0, where its argument is 0. So set that equal, that argument equal to 0, and you can see then that x is equal to ct, so this thing propagates to the right. That point there, x equals ct, will have the value that the function had at t equals to 0 and the origin. And so that will just simply, that location of g, whatever it is, will propagate then to the right. Okay, and the same thing then, a function x plus ct is also a solution to the wave equation, propagates to the left. And the speed of propagation is c in both cases. Propagates with that speed either to the left or to the right. Okay, now you find out also, if you have a function f of x of t that satisfies the wave equation in terms of the D'Alembertian acting on this thing is 0, and you have a function h of t is 0, then the linear superposition will also be a function of the wave equation. And that's because these operators are linear operators. A partial derivative of two functions is the sum of the derivatives. And the same thing for the second derivatives and so forth. So D is a linear operator because it's composed of derivatives, which are themselves linear operators. the D'Alembert is linear. Okay, and picking another form, f of x of t is equal, oh, I'm sorry, back up. You may have two functions, f and g, f and h are themselves solutions to the wave equation, f and h. But f times h is not a solution in general to the wave equation. So the superposition works only by addition, but not multiplication, for example, or any other combination. Superposition is expressed, the physical principle of superposition for us is expressed as simply that the functions are additive. One solution is something which is a solution of the wave equation is also can be superimposed with other solutions additively. Okay, and plugging this particular form, this is very similar looking solution. It's slightly different from the other one, but we find here that this will be a solution to the wave equation. Puts a restriction on k and omega, which is that omega has to be equal to kc for it to be a solution to the wave equation. You get second derivative times omega squared over c squared minus k squared. This must be zero, and that's going to be zero for any g as long as x and t, as long as that's equal to zero. Okay. All right, which is a property of the Laplana, that dispersion relation. A property of Laplana. Okay, so then we also looked at a solution. In fact, I'm going to jump ahead to this one. We take a sine wave propagating to the right and a sine wave propagating to the left. Again, you apply the condition that, in this case, you look at the argument of the function on the left. This is the right traveling. This is the left traveling. Using trigonometric relations, we can rewrite this as 2 cosine kx cosine omega t. So you see that function for number 6, this is the form for number 6, that function is composed of a right traveling and left traveling waves. It's a superposition, better way to say it. It's a superposition of left and right traveling waves. And in fact, if you plot that as a function of time, plot this as a function of time. So the way to do that of x and t, the way to do that is to pick a time, plot it, pick another time, plot it, pick another time, plot it, and watch how this thing changes. So you make an animation, sort of, manually. And you'll see that this thing is not propagating. It propagates neither to the left nor to the right. It's a standing wave. Where kx is equal to, where the cosine of kx is equal to zero, this wave is always zero. So in other words, at x is equal to pi over k, pi over k plus or minus 3 pi over k, plus or minus 5 pi over k. These are nodes. The wave never has any amplitude at those locations. And at other locations, for example, at x equals 0 or 2 pi over k plus or minus 4 pi over k, there's a max or a min of the wave. So the wave looks like this then. At one time it looks like this. At a later time it might be horizontal like that. Completely horizontal. At a later time, it looks like this, and it oscillates like that back and forth. So it's a standing wave. It's a superposition of right and left traveling waves. So it's a generalization of what we were looking at before. Okay. Questions about the homework? Yes, ma'am. Correct. Yeah, that factor of 2 comes about because both of these two waves have an amplitude of 1. They have equal amplitude, and so they combined produce an amplitude of 2. If their amplitudes were not equal, that is, if I had a different amplitude of the left and right traveling waves, then one would dominate over the other, so you'd still have some traveling portion left. But because I constructed that cosine kx minus omega t plus cosine kx plus omega t, left and right traveling waves have the same amplitude, so they perfectly cancel each other at the nodes, and there is no propagation to the left or to the right. It's simply a standing. So there are a lot of interesting things about light that you can talk about. And actually, let me say one more thing. I should have said it back when we were talking about how the A field, the traveling A field, was propagated. I just wanted to be sure everybody knew this. I'm not sure we mentioned it in class. If I take a wire loop like this and connect leads to it and somehow hook it up so that this thing can spin around its diameter like that, and then I produce a magnetic field perpendicular to this, right? So it's like a spinning penny, like this, and the magnetic field is parallel to the table, like this. This produces an AC current in that loop, right? You can use Faraday's law. So this produces an AC current in the loop. And you could hook this up to an antenna then. And so this would be a natural way to produce an AC antenna, just to have something like that. Of course, and that's how AC current is generated in the household current, stuff that we have in the wall. Is generated by taking coils that are spinning in a magnetic field, and usually it's hydro or something that's causing water pressure, something that's causing the coils to spin in the magnetic field, but that's how AC current is generated for our use. So you could use that to construct the antenna that has a pure frequency. Yes, sir?
So you get an AC current, even if it's spinning the same way the whole time?